What's up, my random scientists? Welcome to my crazy channel. As the title suggests, today we'll talk about origin of the term aphrodisiac and the idea behind the term itself, you know, all kind of crazy shit. So without any further delay, let's get into it. As I already said, today we will answer one extremely important and even crucial question for our existence. Why do we say aphrodisiac for aphrodisiacs? So why? So fools may wonder. JK, give me some slack, you damn April fools. Let me answer the precise question I ask myself. No. Sorry about that. First, you know, I need to take some time to tell you a fun but extremely politically incorrect story that made me make this video. Actually, when I think about it, it's not even fun. But it's extremely politically incorrect. It was just a regular Sunday for me, lying on the couch, eating crisps, being bored, you know, pondering about endless possibilities and ideas for next video, and of course why I wouldn't be able to make them into reality. And then, all of a sudden, I noticed a particular TV ad. It was an ad for sexual performance enhancer called Afrička šljiva, literally meaning African plum. As you can see, it's quite a bizarre one, but it got me thinking. You know, term aphrodisiac, and why do we use it? It hit me and, you know, it was so dumb. My first and most intuitive association was, it was based on my native language and two weird coincidences. So first of all, aphrodisiac in my language is spelled afro with like afro. And other part of the name, disiac, sounds really similar to verb disati, that means to take something up, to lift something, essentially. Take those two informations and look at the ad just one more time, and especially the slogan, you know, African plum doesn't fall. I think you got a clear picture of what my association was. And I know it's weird and maybe a bit rude, especially for me to say it in the video, but I had to share it. And once I was intrigued with this ad, I rushed to the computer, I googled everything, checked, and I was relieved. The term wasn't a weird racist origin, but in fact, of ancient Greek origin. Who would have thought? Aphrodikos actually means...
I usually get up at 7 o'clock.
Aphrodikos, such a terrible pronunciation. So, aphrobip actually means deriving or pertaining to or sacred to Aphrodite, Greek goddess of love. Today, it is used both as a noun and as an adjective. Before 1775, the term aphrodisiacal was used as an adjective, you know, like, yeah, it was so aphrodisiacal, I guess.
Uh-oh. Your powers are weak, old man. Obi-Wan!
Boy, you got here just in time.
And the adjective itself has two other adjectives emerging from it. So, anaphrodisiac, meaning diminishing or lacking of sexual desire, or antaphrodisiac, meaning something used against sexual desire, and later referring that something is used against venereal disease, or medicines used against venereal disease that are called antaphrodisiacs. So, yeah, that's for the boring part. Sorry, linguists. Well, many crazy shits have been used for aphrodisiacs all over the world through entire human history. Almost every culture had, and the ones that are still out there still have, ideas about taking some weird substance that can enhance sexual desire, fertility, and even some nice love potions. That weird substance most likely being food, though things could get really insane in some cultures, but we'll get to it. Today, we have some aphrodisiacs that genuinely play with experience of sexual attraction and sex pretty hard in general. Some light versions people use is like weed or taking few drinks, while on the other, more destructive side, we have amphetamines and cocaine that can enhance experience manifold and increase chance of unsafe sexual encounters or like heart attack or something. Other options is using pure testosterone. Like bodybuilders, but with varying degree of effectiveness. If you lack testosterone severely, it will be very helpful, otherwise not so much. Important distinction between the aphrodisiacs used now and the ones already used in history is that most of them were used to treat erectile dysfunction, and today, fortunately, we have modern medicine, by far the most effective, and for the one caused with, you know, bad circulation, we have Viagra, king of all aphrodisiacs if you count it. But people in ancient times had to do with some creative magic to try to solve their problems.
I'm so nervous!
Oh, God, you love your soul!
For example, Aztec kings thought chocolate was great for helping people get to it. All ancient civilization passed down recipes, ideas for weird aphrodisiacs such as volcanic ash, sperm, animal and human, animal testicles, and so on. You get the picture. Some were really gross, risking infections, really dangerous, probably also not very effective. But most of them, especially ones still passed down to us in modern culture, are nice and funny for the most part. For example, in my home country of Montenegro and in neighboring region, we believe that a nice mix of walnuts and honey is the best thing for such uses. While I haven't tried it yet, one day I very well might. And while we are at it, does your culture have some unique and interesting aphrodisiacs? Please let us know in the comment, and if you tried any, let me know what do you think. Is it effective? Maybe even share some juicy story about it experience. Actually, when I think about it, maybe it's best not to. We don't want to anger YouTube algorithm. On the other hand, this video is almost certainly getting demonetized, so bring it on, babies. Turn the comment section into erotic stories forum if you want to. I talk too much again. Anyway, if you like video, leave like, comment your ideas about future videos, and subscribe for more.